So, I live in this really old town with a lot of history and a lot of folklore. It's in the middle of nowhere, and things happen here that I'm pretty sure would be considered weird. But I don't know. I've been here my whole life, and I barely step foot outside of here or any of the surrounding towns, which are also pretty weird. Anyway, a friend and I found this note in an old shack near the woods that I've digitally transcribed to upload here. There wasn't an author or a date or anything either. It was a freaky read. At least, I guess. But we couldn't pinpoint the location of the story. In any case, it's fun to get lost in a ghost story now and then, even if it isn't a ghost story at all. I've been dealing with a nasty phobia for a really long time, but I've refused to let myself think about its origin too much. I don't want to talk about it, not over the phone, not anonymously. I don't want to put it in the world anywhere, but a box beneath my bed. That's why I'm writing it on paper, so that I can lock it up, in hopes that it'll be locked up within my own mind, which probably isn't how that works. It's beetles. Beetles specifically. I used to like nature. All aspects of it, including its creatures. Though now I find myself on the top floor of an apartment building in the middle of Chicago, trying my best to get away from insects and trees, especially pines. I can't go near the things now. I figured if I write my story down as a story, maybe I can sort of distance myself from it. I'm not sure. I'm grasping at straws here. Grasping at sanity, too. Thinking about it hurts my brain. Physically hurts it. And the more I think, the more they show up. So, let's get this over with. It was the summer of 2005, and one of my buddies had invited me over. Not explicitly, really, but he flaunted a copy of Resident Evil 4 like it was a doctor's degree. I must have been around 14 at the time. It was July. 8th grade had ended a month ago. High school daunted the hell out of me, but that's not really pertinent. The town I lived in was small and hilly and grassy. There was jack to do, but it was always pretty. That's something I admired about the place. All the trees, the creeks, the lush green wilderness. See, back then, I had what I thought was a really profound affection for nature. Now I shack up in an apartment, avoiding all of the stuff that I used to adore. That really makes me sad, not being able to enjoy it as I once did. But nostalgia has no power over terror. I didn't plan on witnessing trauma in a pure form that day. It just happened. I didn't plan for that part of my life to dwindle away. Sweat poured out from beneath my baseball cap in dry weather that couldn't have been less than 95 degrees. I was taking a wooded trail to my friend's house on a mangled pile of rust that some would generously deem a bike. One which I rescued from a dump with hopes of renewal. Clotted gears and dense pedals didn't make the heat feel any better. If it wasn't for the bright overhead canopy of the trees, I think I would have passed out from heat stroke. Luckily, my young body was determined. Bike rides like that give a person a lot of time to think and a lot of time to observe. Being the kind of kid that I was, I tried to take in as much of the vibrant green imagery as I could. Tried to forever save it up in a mental memory bank. Starting as a pasture at the bottom, the gentle slope that I climbed gradually grew into a forest at the top. I was getting awfully close to the thick woods that dominated the apex. It's hard to know how far away I was from my buddy's house. The distance blurs in my memory, but I was sure that it wouldn't be much further. A freeing breath entered my lungs once I realized I had crossed the brunt of the climb and was now riding on mostly flat ground. I had reached the most wooded part of the ride, and I was absolutely loving it. Most of the trees were the same or similar. I was an admirer of nature's work, but I knew next to nothing about it. The names or species evaded me. I only recognized their bright green colors in contrast to their darker brown trunks. And then, there was another tree. It was dead. A colossal pine. Such a dark shade of brown, it was nearly black and so twisted that it looked like it was right out of The Nightmare Before Christmas. Its bark was worn and jagged and looked strong as if it was carved from primordial bedrock. No needles dared to grace its mangled hide. There was no life at all. In the center, it held a large black knot that looked like an open maw. Branches around that knot were bent out of its way, grown out of its way, almost like it was beckoning strangers to become visitors. Like arms bracing for a hug. It was like an eye, but sideways and empty. The ball had been popped out of the orbit ages ago, about when Jerusalem was founded. This tree looked as if it had seen the birth of time itself. After I pried my eyes from its mangled, thorny mess of branches, which formed a cloud of shade beneath it, I noticed the most shocking thing. A tent. Well, it was more of a fort. In any case, it was trampled and laying in ruins. There was a blanket, a picnic basket, a ruffled tarp that I think would have been the roof of the fort, but I didn't stick around long enough to look for branches or anything that could have propped it up. It could have been a couple's spot, a homeless guy's, or just some poor bastard's makeshift den. Could have been anyone's camp, really. Nothing was glaringly wrong. Just some sick feeling curdling in the bottom of my gut. I was no detective, but there was something inherently twisted about anything resembling a wreck. And that spot was a wreck. The bottom blanket was folded and shaken as if whoever was lying on it decided to do jumping jacks. The top tarp was even ripped a little, but that could have just been natural weathering. The scene was enough to stir me, enough to make me want to forget about it, so I just kept biking. By the time I had reached my buddy's house, it was around noon, and the heat had noticeably ramped up a few degrees. We had a good time. He was already practically expecting me. I tried to forget about the tree while I watched him play, but something about it didn't really sit well with me. I tried rationalizing it out, but paranoia has a funny way of messing that up. I figured that I would just bike back the way that I had come, and if I didn't see any blankets, then whoever was there in the first place had probably just come back, gotten their stuff, and left. Meaning that they weren't dead or missing. If not, well, then I'd have to figure it out from there. After something like 7 hours of game time, his mom came down to the basement and told us to play outside. Neither of us wanted to. It was still pretty hot out. Instead, we said our goodbyes and I left. Dark hadn't fallen yet, and the sun was only crouching behind the horizon. casting a yellow glow that was dimming by the minute. I felt my gut twist when I saw the blanket. Everything was still there. I had this strange fear that the tree would hear me, so I pedaled slowly when I approached it. As I neared it, a gentle, refreshing gust blew in the direction of the tree. Then I made the worst decision of my life. I don't even remember what drove me to do it, why I thought that it would be a good idea, or even how the thought appeared in my mind. I jumped off my bike, and I walked to the old black trunk. Its bark felt like stone, just as it looked. The ground beneath it was riddled with rock-hard serpents that sprouted from the trunk and dipped far into the earth to drink its nectar. And then there was the knot, darker than the bark, perhaps darker than the night. Branches bent away from it like even they were trying desperately to avoid the abyss. There was a primal pheromone coming from that hole. The air was sweeter around it. I recognized that as I stepped towards it. Then I shivered. Sweat dropped off my head and I walked backwards. I was investigating the blankets and the picnic basket when I heard an old voice singing. It was gentle with brittle age. My body acted without my mind, scrambling backwards and tripping over one of the thick, winding roots. It could have been a rock or another part of the tree, but I hit my head on something hard enough to knock the fight or flight out of me for a moment. That's when I caught some of the words, and I haven't forgotten them yet. I still dream of them. Sometimes, if I'm alone in the dark and it's dead quiet, or if I'm somewhere so loud and packed with people that there's a constant buzz of sound, my mind will play tricks on me, and I'll hear it again.
Deep in the oak, my dear son choked, trapped in the roots and dirt. Oh, I put him there when he declared that the beatings were the most he had heard.
The old voice kept singing in a dusty vibrato, but the horror got my blood pumping too loud for me to hear the rest. It hadn't occurred to me to move yet. The image shocked the will out of my body. First were the lights, but they weren't really lights. It was a dull glow, like phosphorescence, but dimmer and white. They were eyes, white and lacking irises. They were loose, unfixed, and not able to keep staring in one direction before they bobbed somewhere else. Then there was the antennae. That's when I got up. I tried to, at least. Two long, segmented, and excitedly whipping stalks slowly bent up from the chasm as I struggled to move. My foot was stuck. I thought whatever it was had gotten me, and that the best that I could do was to try to wrestle my way free through sheer force. The thought of whatever it was having a hold of me charged my muscles with maniac power, and that was enough to loosen the grip. It was only a root. I've never felt fear like that any other time in my life. I know it's stupid and cliche in horror movies for the person being chased to fall down, but I get it. There was too much energy. It felt like a dream, like punching underwater in a way. Instead of punching underwater, though, it was running, and you were suspended by wires. They would lift you up and drop you without any warning. I wasn't completely screwed. I made it to my bike, but lacked the finesse to actually get on. My hands would vibrate off the handles before even getting a grip, and I couldn't lift my legs without a spasmodic kick. So I just ran, stuck in a nightmarish dream body that refused to listen to my screaming brain. I was making distance, but I could hear it echoing through the woods. The fruits of its sustained voice bounced off the trees. I heard this other line.
My wife did start, nearly stopped her heart. When she saw her son again, she screamed so loud you ne'er heard such a sound. When she saw our face in the rain.
Even now, I couldn't rationally tell you what possessed me. Curiosity, I suppose. The ultimate undoing. But I dared to glance back. There was a face. I don't know whose face, but it was pink and fleshy and round, not cut or harmed, clean and spotless, like immaculate ceramic. The details fuzzed out when I realized that it was plastered on the front of a giant triangular beetle's head. The antennae thwacked vigorously against the trees when it noticed my face contort. Most things afterward are blank. Vaguely, I remember howling at my friend's parents to call the police after I had gathered my thoughts enough to do so. I don't know how I tried to explain it to them. The police were called, mostly to get me under control, and in a psych ward or a halfway point to one. But they did check out the tree. They thought that the giant beetle might have been my own subconscious fabricating a monster to distance reality from me seeing a murder. I don't know. Maybe it did. They only found a yard-deep hole in the trunk, with a small, clotted blood pool at the bottom. I don't know whose blood. I never really wanted to know. It's nice to get this story out there, but telling the story doesn't really solve my problem. There is a persistent issue still occurring, leading me to believe that this was not just my subconscious. You see, I live in Chicago, a city, in an apartment building a few dozen blocks from the nearest park. I live on the top floor, and exterminators have ruled the premises clean, time and time again. And yet, I still find beetles in my room. It's always the same species, too. Monocamus, the sour beetle. It's like three times a week that I'll find one in my sink or in a pantry. One horrible morning, I found one on my pillow, watching me sleep, until I splattered it, of course. They're native to North America, but not to Chicago. The more I think about the tree incident, the more I find them about the place. So I'm sure that this writing session will leave me with more guessed than usual. But I think that getting it out could help, well, get it out. I've been thinking about contacting a priest or a shaman or something. The bites don't hurt much, but they give me nightmares. I want to know what that song was about. Maybe one day I'll look around my old stomping grounds. No, I'd rather let one of the bugs crawl on my face. And that is that. I doubt anything about this or the song will pop up again, especially in town, but if it does, I'll upload another story or note or whatever. In the meantime, I think I'll post about other stories my friends and I have in Nowheresville, not the actual name of the town. Again, I don't know if the author saw the beetle in town, but if it were to take place anywhere in the world, it would definitely be here.